negatively charged with surface charge density sigma 2. So now the situation looks like this. So this is positively charged sheet with surface charge density sigma 1. The electric field lines from this sheet will be pointing outwards from the sheet like this. So this will be the direction of the electric field, and you can be marking it as E1. So E1 is the electric field due to positively charged sheet, and it is outwards. Why so? Because from a positive charge, the electric field will always be pointing outward from the positive charge. Now we are having another sheet, and this is negatively charged. Since this sheet is negatively charged, the electric field line, because of this negatively charged sheet, will be coming towards it. So it will be like this. The electric field will be coming towards the negatively charged sheet. All right. Same thing we have to do. We need to find the electric field because of these two sheets in three different regions. So let's find it out in region 1. You can see this thing in region 1, electric field, that is E1 due to the positively charged sheet, is in this direction, and E2, electric field due to the negatively charged sheet, is in this direction. So these two electric fields, they are cancelling each other. Since sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2, I have taken this sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2, what I will be doing? The net electric field will be in the direction of E1 only, because E1 will be greater than E2. But the net electric field will be the difference of these two. The magnitude will be the difference of E1 and E2, because they are moving, acting in opposite directions. So the net electric field E, it comes out to be sigma 1 minus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. So in region 1, it is sigma 1 minus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught, because it is E1 minus E2. E1 is sigma 1 upon 2 epsilon naught. That the result that we have derived, from which I have written it, sigma 1 upon 2 epsilon naught, and E2 is sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. Since they are acting in opposite direction, we have done a subtraction. All right. In region 2, they both are acting along the same direction. E1 and E2, they are both acting along the same direction. Since they are acting along the same direction, the net electric field will also be in the direction of E1 and E2. And the net electric field is the sum of E1 and E2. That is sigma 1 upon 2 epsilon naught plus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. All right. Similar is the case in region 3. In region 3, E1 is acting in a direction right of this orange color sheet, negatively charged sheet, and E2 is towards this negatively charged sheet. So the net electric field will be in the direction of E1, because I have taken sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2. And now the net electric field will be the difference of E1 and E2. That will be sigma 1 minus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. All right. So this is the electric field in three different regions because of two infinitely charged plane sheets which are carrying opposite charges. All right. So they are carrying opposite charges. That's why in region 1, 2, and 3, we are having these values of electric field. And the electric field because of a plane sheet do not depend on the distance. That's why on every point in this region, it will be having the same value. On every point in this region, it will be having this value. On every point in region 3, it will be having this value. So let's summarize it up. In region 1, it is E1 minus E2. That is sigma 1 minus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. In region 2, it is E1 plus E2. That is sigma 1 plus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. And in region 3, it is sigma, again, E is equal to E1 minus E2. That is sigma 1 minus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. So this is case 2. Now, very quickly, we'll be doing case 3. And it is very easy. Case 3 is just very similar to case 2. Just we have changed the value of sigma 1 and sigma 2 as some fixed value as sigma. So I'll be just moving towards the case 3. So in case 3, we are having one sheet that is positively charged, having surface charge density sigma, and another sheet that is negatively charged, and it is also having a surface charge density minus sigma. All right. So this is my positively charged sheet. From the positively charged sheet, the electric field lines will be coming outwards like this. So this is my E1 because of this positively charged sheet. And also I am having a negatively charged sheet, which is having a surface charge density as minus sigma. So from this minus sigma, the electric field lines will be coming towards it. So this will be the direction of the electric field lines because of this negatively charged sheet. So we need to find the electric field in region 1, 2 and 3. Let's do it. In region 1, electric field will be 0. Why so? Because E1 and E2, they are acting in opposite directions, and E1 is equal to E2. All right, E1 and E2, they are acting in opposite directions, and E1 is equal to E2, so they get cancelled out. Sigma upon 2 epsilon naught minus sigma upon 2 epsilon naught, and it will be equal to 0. All right, like this, sigma upon 2 epsilon naught minus sigma upon 2 epsilon naught, and it will be 0 only in region 1. In region 2, the electric field, because of these two sheets, they are acting in the same direction, so that's why it will be not equal to 0, and the direction will be towards the direction of E1 and E2, and it is sigma plus sigma upon 2 epsilon naught, because sigma upon 2 epsilon naught is E1 and E2 is also sigma upon 2 epsilon naught. When you add it up, is sigma plus sigma upon 2 epsilon naught, and then this 2 gets cancelled out with this 2, you are left with the final expression as sigma upon epsilon naught. So in this region, the electric field gets added up, and the final expression of the electric field comes out to be sigma upon epsilon naught. In region 3, it will be again 0, because E1 is equal to E2 and they both are acting in opposite direction. We will be having sigma upon 2 epsilon naught minus sigma upon 2 epsilon naught, and it will be is equal to 0. So let's sum it up. In region 1, both E1 and E2, they are acting in opposite direction. That's why they are, since they are having same surface charge density, the value of electric field is also same. That is sigma upon 2 epsilon naught, and they are acting in opposite direction, then they will be getting cancelled out, and the net electric field in region 1 comes out to be 0. In region 2, the electric field will be added up because they are acting in the same direction, and then it comes out to be sigma upon epsilon naught. In region 3, again, it will be 0 because they are acting in opposite direction, and E1 and E2, they are having the same value. So this is the application of the result that we have obtained for a plane sheet. So even in case of two sheets, we can apply it, or maybe in three sheets, we can apply it. But up to two is in your syllabus. Other than that, it's not in your syllabus actually. So we can easily be finding out this electric field in region 1 and 2, as well as in region 3. So if you are having some doubt, please ask. I'll be just stopping it here before taking up the next application. Please ask your doubt. So let's take case 1, as Nivedita has asked this question to repeat this case 1. So let's take case 1 again. In case 1, we are having two positively charged sheets with surface charge density sigma 1 and sigma 2. So this is my first sheet. It is having a surface charge density sigma 1. The electric field lines will be coming out from it. This is E1 and it is coming out from the positively charged sheet. Again, I am having another positively charged sheet, and it is having a surface charge density sigma 2. All right. And this sigma 2, because of this positively charged sheet, we are having the electric field lines that are coming out from it. So they will be coming out from it in like this, from this sheet, the orange color sheet, they are coming out from it. We need to find the electric field in region 1. So in region 1, both E1 and E2, they are acting in the same direction towards the left of blue colored sheet, and they will be added up. So the net electric field in region 1 will be E1 plus E2. E1 is sigma 1 upon 2 epsilon naught, and E2 is sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. So E1 is sigma 1 upon 2 epsilon naught, E2 is sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. When we'll be adding it up, it becomes sigma 1 plus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. So in this region, the net electric field will be in a direction towards the left of the blue colored sheet, and it is having a value sigma 1 plus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon. Now we need to find the electric field in region 2. So in region 2, E1 is acting in direction towards the right of this blue colored sheet, and E2 is acting in a direction towards the left of this orange colored sheet. Since E1 is greater than E2 and they both are acting in opposite direction, the net electric field will be in direction of E1 because it is having somewhat more value than that of E2, and the net electric field magnitude can be obtained by subtracting the magnitude of E1 and E2. They are acting in opposite directions. You can see this is the direction for E1, this is the direction for E2. So it will be sigma 1 minus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. Sigma 1 upon 2 epsilon naught is for E1, and sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught is for E2. And you need to subtract it up. Why so? Because they are acting in opposite direction. They are the vectors, and in the vectors, they are opposite, acting in opposite direction. We can easily be subtracting them out. Similarly, in case 3, same is the case that of region 1. In region 3, we are having the net electric field in a direction towards the right of this orange colored sheet, and it will be E1 plus E2, that is sigma 1 upon 2 epsilon naught plus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught, and it will be sigma 1 plus sigma 2 upon 2 epsilon naught. So let's summarize it up. You can easily be seeing this thing. I hope that I am clear. So if you are having some doubt, please ask. Then only I'll be taking up the next derivation or the next application of the Gauss's law. The third application of the Gauss's law, it says that we need to apply the Gauss's law to find the electric field intensity due to a uniformly charged thin spherical shell. That is not this. This is thin spherical shell. All right. Please mark it thin. So it is thin spherical shell. All right. So electric field intensity due to a uniformed charged thin spherical shell. Spherical shell means that something comparable to a football, that is hollow inside. All right. And it is very thin. So please consider it is a sphere. It is not a circle. I won't be able to draw it in 3D. That's why you have to, you can only be drawing it in 2D, and you have to draw it like a circle, but consider it as a sphere. It is a sphere, all right, like a football. So we need to calculate the electric field because of this thin spherically charged shell, all right. And first we'll be taking a point P which is outside the shell. So this is my spherical shell, and a point P is there which is lying somewhere over here, which is outside this shell. All right. So there can be three possibilities. One, the point can be lying outside the shell. Other, the point can be lying on this shell, and it can also be lying inside the shell. So first I'm taking at a point capital P, which is lying outside this shell. All right. So consider a positively charged spherical shell with center O and radius R. So this is the center O of the spherical shell, and the radius of this spherical shell is capital R, and it is hollow sphere. Because spherical shell is hollow, just like a football. All right. So we have taken a spherical shell with center O, and the radius is capital R. All right. Now, let P be a point outside the shell at a distance small r from the center O. Okay. So this is my point P, and this point P is at a distance small r from center O. All right. So this is point P. It is at a distance small r from the center O. In order to apply the Gauss's law, we need to take a Gaussian surface. And in this case, we will be taking the Gaussian surface as a sphere. Because of the symmetry of the spherical shell, it is easy to take a sphere and calculate the surface area of that. So that's why we will be taking up a sphere in this case. So the Gaussian surface in this case will be in the form of a sphere of radius small r, such that this point P will lies on the surface of that Gaussian surface. So this is our point of interest, point P. At this, we need to find the electric field. So we'll be taking a Gaussian surface like this. So this dotted line is our Gaussian surface. It is in the form of a sphere, and the radius of this Gaussian surface is small r. Why we have taken it of small r? Because we wanted this thing that this point P should be lying on the surface of this Gaussian surface. And since this point P is at a distance small r from the center O, we need to take a Gaussian surface of radius small r. All right. So this dotted line is our Gaussian surface, that is a sphere of radius small r, such that the point P lies on its surface. This point P is lying on the surface of this Gaussian surface that we have taken. Okay. Please draw it. I'm just waiting for 30-40 seconds so that you will be able to draw it up. The point P is lying on the surface of this Gaussian surface. Now, we need to take the small area vector because we need to calculate the flux. And for calculating the flux, what we'll be doing, we'll be taking a small area vector, that is ds, and then we can easily be calculating the flux through the Gaussian surface by using the formula E dot ds integration. So for that, we have taken a small area vector, that is ds. So this is my small surface, and from this I have taken a small area vector ds. Ds is always perpendicular to the surface. It will be moving radially outward. Radially outward means that along the radius, because everything along the radius will be 90 degree only. So this is the 90 degree to the surface. That's why this ds vector is your small area vector, that is of, we have taken, and it is acting radially outwards. Also the electric field, because of this spherical charge, thin spherical shell that is uniformly charged, is also acting radially outwards. So it will always be radially outwards from this positive charge. We know this thing. It will be like this. All right. So this is the, this red colored is my electric field. Okay. And the purple colored is my area vector. We can see this thing, that both this ds vector and electric field vector, they are pointing radially outwards such that the angle between them is 0 degree. You can see it clearly. The angle between the ds vector as well as the electric field vector at point P is what? 0 degree, because they are both acting along the radius and they are both having an angle 0 degree between them. They are both acting in the same direction. Okay. So angle between ds and E vector is 0 degree. Please write it and record these things so that we will be using it to solve up the derivation later on. So I'm just giving you 30 seconds to do that. Now we need to find the electric flux through this Gaussian surface by using the formula phi E is equal to E dot ds integration. So that we can easily be doing it. The total flux linked with the Gaussian surface is given by the formula phi E is equal to E dot ds integration. And when you open this dot product, it will be E ds cos theta, and the angle between ds and E is 0 degree. So you can be writing it like this, that it is equal to E ds cos theta, and theta is what? 0 degree, because both ds and electric field vector, they are acting along the same direction. So cos 0 is 1, and the expression becomes phi E is equal to E integration ds, and ds is what? The integration of the Gaussian surface. So the integration of a sphere, the surface area of a sphere, is what? 4 pi r square. That is the radius square, and the radius of this Gaussian surface is small r. So we'll be writing it like this. The total flux linked with the Gaussian surface has come out to be E multiplied by 4 pi r square. The integration of this ds is the complete value of the surface area of the Gaussian surface. And we know for a sphere, the surface area is given by 4 pi into radius square. Radius of the Gaussian surface is small r. That's why it is 4 pi small r square. This is our equation number 1. That is, the flux linked with the Gaussian surface with the help of the formula integration E dot ds that we have done. Now we need to find the electric flux through the Gaussian surface using the Gauss's law. So then we will be equating it up, the same thing that we will be doing, we have been doing for the last two derivations. So now the total flux linked with the Gaussian surface is also given by the Gauss's law. So it is phi E is equal to Q upon epsilon naught. This is the Gauss's law statement. The mathematical expression of Gauss's law says that the flux linked with the surface is given by the total charge enclosed by the surface divided by epsilon naught. What is the total charge enclosed by the surface? It is the charge enclosed by the surface of this hollow sphere. All right. The hollow spherical shell, it is whatever be the charge present on that hollow spherical shell, all the charge is enclosed by the Gaussian surface. You can see it. All right. So this spherical shell is enclosing, the Gaussian surface is enclosing all the charge that is present on the hollow spherical shell. And this value of this Q can easily be written as, okay, Nivedita is asking a question, so let me answer her first. Yes, Nivedita, go ahead. Yes, Nivedita.
Electric flux is pointing outside.
From a spherical charge shell, the electric field is always pointing towards its radius. It is radially outward from it. All right? That's why.
Yes, sir.
Now, the total flux linked with this Gaussian surface, it can be calculated with the help of the Gauss's law, that is Q upon epsilon naught. The value of this Q is the surface charge density of this thin spherical shell multiplied by its surface area. And the Gaussian surface is enclosing a charge that is present in the area 4 pi r square. That is the surface area of this thin spherical shell. So whatever be the charge present in this area, it is enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So you can write Q is equal to sigma into 4 pi capital R square, where sigma is the surface charge density of this thin spherical shell. All right. So Q is equal to sigma into A. We know this. And in place of A, I have written 4 pi capital R square, because the value of the surface area of the thin spherical shell is 4 pi capital R square. Okay. So in place of this Q, I can be writing sigma into 4 pi capital R square. So this becomes the flux linked with the Gaussian surface by the Gauss's law is sigma into 4 pi capital R square upon epsilon naught. And this is our equation number 2. I'm telling you again, all the charge that is present on the holosphere is enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So that value of that charge is equal to the surface charge density of the thin spherical shell multiplied by its surface area. We know this Q is equal to sigma into A. So A over here is 4 pi capital R square, because it is the area in which the charge is present. All right. That's why in place of Q, we have written sigma into 4 pi capital R square. This is our equation number 2. Equation number 1 was E into 4 pi small r square, and equation number 2 was sigma into 4 pi capital R square upon epsilon naught. They both are representing the electric flux. They both are equal. So from 1 and 2, we can easily be writing E multiplied by 4 pi small r square is equal to sigma 4 pi capital R square upon epsilon naught. 4 pi gets cancelled out with this 4 pi, and you are left with E is equal to sigma capital R square upon r square into epsilon naught. So you are left with sigma r square, that is the capital R square, where r, capital R, is the radius of the thin spherical shell, and small r is the distance of the point P at which we need to find the electric field. I'm telling you again, capital R is the radius of the thin spherical shell, and small r is the distance at which we need to find the electric field. All right. So this is the electric field at a point outside the charge shell. So it is the electric field expression at a point outside the charge shell. We can also be writing one alternate expression for this electric field. How so? In place of this sigma, I can be writing Q upon sigma is what? Surface charge density, that is charge per unit area. All right. So in place of this sigma, I can be writing Q upon 4 pi capital R square. All right or not? In place of this sigma, I can be writing this Q upon 4 pi capital R square. All right. I can be writing like this, or I should be writing it with the help of a pencil itself. So in place of sigma, I can be writing what? Sigma is equal to Q by A, capital A. This we know, surface charge density. And in place of A, I can be writing, so that is equal to Q upon 4 4 pi. It is my pi. All right. And it is capital R square. So I can easily be writing it like this. So in place of sigma, it is 4 pi q upon 4 pi capital R square. So when I replace it with this R square, get cancelled out with this R square, and you are left with an expression like this. All right. So you are left with an expression like this. So I'm just erasing it out, and then I'll be giving you the expression, that final expression or the alternate expression for the electric field, that we are able to write it up. All right. I hope that you have written it. So this is my alternate expression. Because with the help, this q upon 4 pi capital R square. So capital R square get cancelled out with capital R square, and you are left with q upon 4 pi epsilon naught R square. All right. So this is one alternate expression for the electric field due to a spherical charge, uniformly charged hollow spherical shell at a distance small r from the center of the cell. All right. Now let's take the second case. That is when this point P is on this shell. When this point P lies on this shell. All right. So on the surface of the spherical shell, if we are the point of interest, that is point P, it is lying on the surface, then what will be the value of the electric field on the surface? And then we'll be taking the case third, that is when this point P will be lying inside it. All right. So let's do the example for the Aditya has raised hand, so let me answer him first, and then we'll be moving ahead. Yes, Aditya, go ahead with your question. So Aditya wants me to explain the alternate equation. So let me explaining the alternate equation. In place of the sigma, I can be writing q upon 4 pi capital R square. So in place of the sigma, what I can be writing? Q upon 4 pi capital R square. And that capital R square will get cancelled out in numerator and denominator. And you are left with E is equal to q upon 4 pi epsilon naught R square. Okay. You are left with q upon 4 pi epsilon naught R square. Because this capital R square will get cancelled out with the capital R square. This sigma is charge upon surface area of this hollow sphere. And the surface area of this hollow sphere is 4 pi capital R square. All right. I hope that I am clear. I should be moving towards the next case. We need to find the electric field at a point A on the surface of the shell. Okay. We need to find the electric field at a point A on the surface of the shell. Please keep your questions for the end. I'll be giving you some time to ask at the end also. Okay. Let me explain this one first. So on the surface of the shell, what we'll be doing now, the Gaussian surface will be this surface, which is along the boundary of this spherical shell only. So now my Gaussian surface, because I want this thing that the Gaussian surface has to be on the point of interest. And now the point of interest lies on the surface of this shell. So what I'll be doing, I'll be considering the same thing, that a charged spherical shell of radius r and center O and capital A be a point which is at a distance capital R from it. Why so? Because now the distance of the point from the center is equal to the radius of the shell, then only it can be on its surface. So distance is capital R. We'll be taking a Gaussian surface in the form of a sphere of radius capital R. All right. You can be seeing that it is because of the dotted line. The Gaussian surface is now on the, over the surface of the given charged spherical shell. And we'll need to calculate the electric flux. Ds be the small area vector and E be the electric field. Both will be pointing radially outward. The direction are same. That's why both are having the angle 0 degree between them. Same things. No need to write all these things again. I have just explained it. That's why I'm writing it up. You just be writing it this thing, that now the Gaussian surface is of radius R only. All these things I have explained it to you earlier. Okay. Now, the flux linked with the Gaussian surface is given by E dot ds, and it is E ds cos theta. Theta is 0 degree because the angle between ds and E is 0 degree, and cos 0 is 1. So, you'll be just left with E integration ds, and integration of ds means the integration of the Gaussian surface, that is 4 pi capital R square. The surface area of the Gaussian surface is 4 pi capital R square. All right. And now we need to find the electric field with the help of the Gauss's law. So the Gauss's law says the total flux linked with the Gaussian surface is also given by the Gauss's law. It is phi equal to Q upon epsilon naught. And in place of Q, I can be writing sigma into 4 pi R square, because the charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface is in this surface, and that is equal to the surface area of the given hollow charge spherical shell, that is 4 pi R square. So in place of this Q, I can be writing sigma into 4 pi R square, and it comes out to be phi equal to sigma into 4 pi capital R square upon epsilon naught. Just you need to replace the small r with capital R. Okay. In all, I can tell you this thing, that the previous case that we have done in this, this capital R was small r because the point was outside. Now the capital R becomes, now the small r becomes capital R because the point is lying on the surface. All right. Again, we need to equate these two equations. They both are representing the flux. And when we will be equating it up from 1 and 2, we will be getting that this 4 pi R square gets cancelled out with this 4 pi R square, and you are left with E is equal to sigma upon epsilon naught. So this is the expression for electric field at a point on the surface of the charge shell. So this point P is lying on the surface of the charge shell. And alternatively, in place of this sigma, you can be writing Q upon surface area. And the surface area is 4 pi capital R square. So this is the alternate expression. In place of sigma, I have written Q upon 4 pi capital R square. Because sigma is surface charge density, charge divided by the surface area. And surface area of the spherical shell is 4 pi capital R square. That's what I have written. So this is one alternate expression. Keep this thing in mind, that it is the electric field at a point on the surface of the thin spherically charged shell. And this is the maximum value of the electric field because of the thin spherical charged shell. If we move away from it, it will be decreasing. All right. Now let's take a point inside. So let B be a point inside the spherical charged shell. And we will be taking a Gaussian surface, such that this point B, it is lying on the surface. This is my point B. See, this is marked with this one. So it is, the B is somewhat written at a bit different point. My point B is this one. I'll be just making it correct. Now see, this is my point B. It is inside the shell. So when it is inside the shell, what I'll be doing, I'll be again taking a charged spherical shell of radius O and R. This is my charge spherical, the green one is my charge spherical shell, and it is having a radius capital R. The Gaussian surface will be having a radius small r, such that the point capital B is lying on the surface of the Gaussian surface. The electric field will be pointing radially outward like this. So the area vector as well as the electric field, they will be pointing radially outward. Now we need to find the electric field at a point B. So let's find the electric flux through the Gaussian surface with the formula phi is equal to E dot ds. All right. The surface area of this Gaussian surface is 4 pi small r square. So then I'll be writing it as 4 pi small r square. It should be 4 pi small r square. So make it 4 pi small r square. Should be 4 pi small r square. Correct. So let me again telling you this thing, that phi is equal to E dot ds. The angle between E and ds is 0. So E ds cos 0, E will be taking out, and integration of ds. Integration of ds means the Gaussian surface. So Gaussian surface is phi is equal to E into 4 pi small r square, because the radius of this Gaussian surface small r. Again, total flux linked with the Gaussian surface is given by Q upon epsilon naught. Now see this thing. This is very important. Please pay attention. The charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface is zero because all the charge is present on the surface of this thin, hollow spherical charge shell, and the Gaussian surface is not having any charge. No charge is present inside the Gaussian surface. So the value of this Q is zero. Since Gaussian surface is not enclosing any charge, the value of Q is zero, and that's why by Gauss's law, the value of flux comes out to be zero, because zero upon epsilon naught is equal to zero. All right. Now, this has to be small r. Please make it small r. I'll be answering all your questions in a while. Just give me 5 more minutes. I'll be answering it up. Okay, so this is your expression that we have derived. So these are the two expressions that we have derived. One is from the E dot ds, that is E into 4 pi r square, and second from the Gauss's law that phi equal to 0. When you equate it out from 1 and 2, we know this thing, this E into 4 pi small r square comes out to be 0. And now 4 pi cannot be 0, r cannot be 0, then E has to be 0. The value of electric field inside the charged spherical shell is zero. So no electric field can be lying inside it, only at the surface. Some electric field is there, that is the maximum electric field at the surface. And when you move away from it, the electric field becomes lesser and lesser. Okay. Now very quickly, we'll be drawing the graph between E and R. So the graph between the electric field and the distance R. So outside the shell, when R is greater than the radius of the shell, so the point is lying outside. The expression was this, Q upon 4 pi epsilon naught into R upon R square. Q upon 4 pi epsilon naught R square was the expression when this point P is lying outside. This is outside case because the distance is greater than the radius of the thin spherical shell. On the surface, the distance was equal to R. So it comes out to be Q upon sigma upon epsilon naught. And inside the R, electric field value comes out to be zero. All right. So we can be drawing the graph like this. So this is the graph. You can see it. So this is the value of the graph. See this thing, that when R is equal to, when this distance is equal to the radius, the value is sigma upon epsilon naught. It is the maximum value Emax. And after that, it is decreasing with the square of the distance. You can see they are inversely proportional. The distance is inversely proportional to the electric field. So after this point, it will be decreasing as a square. Inverse square, so it will be decreasing because they are proportional to the square of it. Distance E and R, here E is proportional to the inverse square of R. That's why it is decreasing like this. And before that, before this distance R, it is zero. The electric field was zero before distance R. So you can be marking it with this. Like, so this is the value of E max, that is sigma upon epsilon naught. And before this, the value is this. You can see that when the point of interest is less than R, the value of E is zero. So I have marked it with red line. It is zero. Up to R, it is zero. At R, it is maximum. And after that, it is decreasing as an inverse square. So this is the graph. Very important graph. Sometimes they may ask in the exam. This is all for today's class. Thank you very much for joining. Now you are open to ask any of your doubts which you are having. I'll be just answering them one by one. Please ask your doubts. Okay. Thank you very much for joining the class. Be safe and ask me any of your doubts. You can easily be mailing me up on any of these two IDs, and I'll be taking one problem solving session very soon. Thank you very much.